Well, it's good to see you here in God's house tonight. I invite you to take your Bibles, open please to the book of Romans chapter 15, and we're going to be dealing with verses 1 to 13, Lord willing. And I want to speak tonight on the subject, how to live for others. That's really the whole theme of this passage we're going to deal with, is living for others, learning to please others. And look at verse 1 of chapter 15 when the Apostle Paul is writing here. He says, "We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak, and not to please ourselves." The idea is we don't live to please ourselves, but we live for others, and we live to please others. We put others in front of us. Someone wrote this. They said, here's a couple of phrases that you will never need to teach your toddler. You never need to teach them, "That's mine," or "Me first." Because they go on to say, because of the fall, we're all kind of pre-wired to put ourselves in first place. And I think we would all agree that part of the sin nature is this innate selfishness that all of us have to deal with. Every one of us, we have this tendency to put ourselves first and in front of others. Now, we've heard the saying, the way you spell joy is Jesus first, others next, and yourself last. But let's be honest, it doesn't really seem that way sometimes. Okay, maybe I'm the only one that thinks that. There was this weird kind of silence there, like, are you our pastor? I mean, you don't seem very sanctified here. But listen to what Jesus said. Jesus taught that self-denial is the path to true joy. He said this, "If anyone wants to come after me, he must what? Deny himself and pick up his cross and follow me. For whosoever seeks to save his life will lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same will find it." And so Jesus taught that the way to true and lasting joy is to forsake yourself and to think of others, to put others in front of you. Now, this is what Paul is trying to teach the believers at the church at Rome. If you've been with us on our study on Romans, you know that in the church at Rome, Paul divides the believers really into two categories. He divides them into people that he called strong believers and those that are weak. Now, who are the strong? The strong believers are believers that believe and understand their liberty in Christ. They have knowledge. They've studied the Word of God. We know that when a person is saved, you have tremendous liberty in the Lord Jesus Christ to do a lot of things. And when we talk about liberty, we're certainly not talking about things that cross the line that are sinful things or moral issues. We're just talking about just general liberty. As a person in Christ, you have a lot of liberty as opposed to those that were in the Old Testament when they had so many laws and restrictions and all those things. Those in the church at Rome that were strong were believers that understood they were no longer were they under some of those Mosaic restrictions that were a part of the Old Testament. And they understood their liberty. They lived in the light of that liberty, and because they understood that what the scripture taught with reference to that. They were the strong believer, but then he made a category of what he calls the weaker brother. Now, that to us seems like a term that is a kind of derogative, but Paul wasn't using it in that way. When he was talking about a weaker brother, he was simply talking about a believer that perhaps didn't really understand all the liberty they have, or perhaps their conscience for some reason would not allow them to practice certain things that other believers felt that they had the liberty to practice. Now, let me just say this. Just because a person was a stronger or perhaps more mature, or we could say more knowledgeable Christian, doesn't make them a more spiritual Christian, I can say that. It doesn't mean that they're more spiritual. A believer can be a weaker believer. That is, they have a very sensitive conscience, and they do not feel that they have the liberty to do certain things, and they follow their conscience, and they can be a very spiritual person. They can walk very close to the Lord. In fact, there were many so-called weaker Christians that did exactly that. They would not allow themselves to enjoy certain liberties because they were afraid that if they did that, they would displease the Lord. And the last thing on earth that they wanted to do was to displease their Savior. And so they were very spiritual. So this isn't an issue of spirituality. You could be categorized as a strong and mature believer and not be very spiritual. You could be categorized as a weaker brother or sister and be very, very spiritual. But nevertheless, this is how Paul divided the believers. because there was a controversy brewing in the church. There were some believers in the church that felt like they had the liberty to go and eat meat sacrificed to idols because they knew that there was nothing about those idols. They were all false gods, which were no gods at all. There was only one true God. So they had no problem going to the meat market and buying meat that was sacrificed to an idol and taking that meat home and eating it. But there was other weaker believers in the church that when they saw that, their conscience was grieved because perhaps they were saved out of a background that was pagan, where they were accustomed to eating meat sacrificed to idols. And now that they were a Christian, now that they're saved, they couldn't imagine doing that thing that they were saved out of, that thing that associated in their mind with worshiping a false God. Their conscience would not allow them to practice that. And so there was this controversy brewing in the church between the stronger believers and the weaker believers. And what Paul's trying to do is he's trying to teach everyone in the church this one basic principle is to receive one another. We have to receive each other. In fact, that's the key verse. Look at verse 7. Wherefore, receive ye one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. These differences of beliefs, these differences over preferences and personal convictions was causing a bit of a division in the church. And Paul wanted to settle that. Because let me tell you something, beloved, one of the greatest dangers that any church will ever face is division in the church. The church needs to stay united. A unity in the New Testament was such an important issue. We read about it all throughout the New Testament. This was the concern of God the Father. The Bible says in the Old Testament how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Unity was compared to a sweet, fragrant offering to the Lord. God loves to see a church that is absolutely unified. It was the concern of God the Father. It was the concern of God the Son. You remember that Jesus, during his great intercessory prayer in John chapter 17, prayed for that one thing, that we would all be one. Listen to what he said in verse 21 of John 17, that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Here's what Jesus is praying. He's praying this for all of us. Because one of the things he said was, is so that the world will believe that thou hast sent me. The way that the world understands that we are truly believers, that there is a Savior that God the Father sent from heaven, is the world looks at us and they see our love and our unity together. And that is a strong message to the world, that Jesus is real, and the message that we proclaim is valid and it's very real. It was the concern of Jesus. It's the concern of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that when the Holy Spirit came to the church at Pentecost, they were all in one accord. This is one of the byproducts of a church that's filled with the Holy Spirit, that there is unity in the church. And so the point is that all throughout the New Testament, we see this unity emphasized because it's so very important in the church. And in fact, Paul has to deal with this one issue in many of the churches that he wrote. He had to deal with it in the church of Philippi. There was a division brewing there. He had to deal with it at the church at Corinth. Certainly there were divisions there at the church at Corinth. And now he's dealing with this issue here at the church at Rome, because you have these two groups of believers, the strong and the weak. And there seems to be a division there brewing between the two, and they're not receiving each other and they're not welcoming each other with open arms. And that was a problem. And so Paul writes to correct this. And what he does is he gives us some principles on how to do that. To again, hold together the unity, which is so very important. Because during my time in ministry, I have to tell you, I've seen churches torn apart. I've seen that. I remember one time I was preaching at a country church down south, and they had asked me to come, and I had to drive a long way, and I drove down the road in a backwoods road, and I saw a church, and this was the name of the church, Occupy Number One Baptist Church. I thought that was kind of an odd name for a church. I continued driving down the road a little ways longer, and there was another church there, and the name of that church was Occupy Number Two Baptist Church. And I continued driving. This is a true story, by the way. I continued driving. I'm not preaching now. I'm telling the truth. I'm just kidding. continued driving and came to another church, and the name of that church was Occupy Number 3 Baptist Church. And I went to finally found my church, thank God, and occupied it. And I asked some of the locals there, what's the deal with this Occupy Number 1 and Occupy Number 2 and Occupy Number 3? And they begin to unfold to me this story of how one church had split over an issue. And then out of that split, there split another church. And this was the names of the churches that they gave. So a person in that local area had to decide which church they were going to go to, Occupy 1, Occupy 2, or Occupy 3. Which, now, when you think about that, what kind of a testimony does that present to the world? I read about another church. It was told of two congregations. They were located only a few blocks from each other in a small community, and they thought it would be good if they would merge together and become one church and become unified, and everyone thought that was a good idea, but they were unable to pull it off. And you know why they were unable to pull it off, the problem? The problem was they couldn't agree on how to recite the Lord's Prayer. Because one group preferred the saying, forgive us our trespasses, while the other group demanded, forgive us our debts. And so they couldn't get together because they had a disagreement. And so the local newspaper reported, one church went back to its trespasses while the other returned to its debts. Again, what kind of a testimony does that present to the world when God's people can't receive one another and love one another? And so Paul is teaching us here, look, the key to this is we don't live to please ourselves. We live to please others. We live for others. And he's going to tell us how to live for others. And it's not a very difficult thing that he tells us here. It's actually two simple principles, important guidelines that we have to remember if we're going to live for others, please others, and by doing that, please the Lord. So let me give you these two guidelines. Number one, very simple, remember the exhortation to live for others. Again, number one, remember the exhortation to live for others. It's a very simple principle. We just read it. Notice the principle in verse number one. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. Look at verse two. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. Now, this is a very simple principle. Paul states it up front. In fact, everything Paul has been saying in the previous verses lead up to this one principle here, that those that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. Those that are more mature, perhaps, maybe have been saved longer, you have more knowledge, and therefore that knowledge, when you educate your conscience through the scriptures, it might educate your conscience so that your conscience doesn't accuse you over practices that are not wrong. And so as you grow in Christ, as you educate your conscience, you learn to put your conscience at rest regarding certain issues. And so a strong person has gotten there. They've learned. They've been educated. And Paul says, you then that are in this category, you ought to help bear the infirmities of the weak. Look at that word ought there. The Greek word here in verse 1 has the idea to be a debtor. In fact, Paul uses the same word in Romans 1:14 when he said, I'm a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians. And so the strong here have a responsibility, Paul says, have a debt to those who perhaps are not as knowledgeable in the things of God, knowledgeable in the word. You have a debt. And look at the word bear. We then are strong, ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. And this word is used more than 25 times in the New Testament. It does not communicate the idea of tolerating someone's inadequacy. It refers to carrying someone's load, shouldering a burden, and doing it in a loving way. For example, this word is used in Galatians 6:2, where it says, to bear ye one another's burdens and so fulfill what? Fulfill the law of Christ. You're fulfilling the law of Christ. What's the law of Christ, by the way? It is the law of love. And so when you have this mindset that you are going to bear the infirmity of perhaps someone that's not maybe where you are spiritually, may have a different set of preferences and convictions, the response to a person like that is not to shun them or push them away and say, oh, you know, you're just a prude. You don't know how to have a good time. No. The response of a child of God who loves their brother or sister in Christ is to bear that with them. Bear the infirmity of the weak. Not that it's a weakness, but you're to go to where they are. And this is where we learned last week. We are to learn to limit our liberties. I might have the liberty to do a lot of things, but there are certain things I'm not going to do if I know that perhaps another brother or sister in Christ will be grieved by me doing that. If I'm hurting them by doing that, if I'm tempting them to go against what their conscience is telling them, that's not a good pattern of behavior. And remember, I've already told you this, that as a Christian, you should never violate your conscience. You should always follow what your conscience tells you, because that conscience is a tool that God uses in the process of sanctification. And a conscience that is yielded to the Holy Spirit, that's learning the Word of God, is an effective tool in this process of making you more like the Lord Jesus. So never go against your conscience. And if a brother sees me doing something and they look at me and they say, well, you know, he's been saved a long time, and even though I think that this is wrong, he's doing it, so maybe I should do it. And even though my conscience tells me not to, and if they see me doing it and they get into a pattern of ignoring their conscience, then that can bring actual destruction to them spiritually. So as a strong person in the Lord, I'm going to want to bear the infirmities of the weak, as Paul said, and I'm not going to please myself. I'm rather going to live for that brother or live for that sister. And I'm going to try to please them. That's what Paul is telling us here. This is the principle. And what's the purpose of this? Again, very simple in verse 2. Let every one of us please his neighbor for what? His good to what? What's the word there? Edification. Edification. And the Greek word is building up. It's the idea of someone who builds an edifice, and it's used here to speak about building up another person spiritually. We want to build another brother or sister spiritually. We want to edify them. We want them to grow in Christ. And so therefore, because I want to see their spiritual growth, I want to see them grow in the Lord. I'm not going to live to please myself. I'm going to live for them. I'm going to live for their edification. This is the whole purpose. And by the way, this is why we come to church. We come to church to edify others. Some people say, well, you know, I don't really need church tonight. Well, someone else needs you to be there. It's not always about you. You know, I get a little impatient with this consumer mentality that people have when they go and visit a church. They're looking for a church home, and so they go to church the same way they go to Walmart. And if they can't find what they're looking for at Walmart, well, then they'll just stop at Target. And they'll just go shop around, and they'll find until they find. And people have this same kind of consumer mentality when they're looking for a church, and they say, oh, you know, I'm going to go to this church and see if they can give me what I want and give me what I need. And I think this is a byproduct of this postmodern generation in which we live, where it's all about me, all about what can you do for me. And people who are believers, when they're searching for a church, I find very few people that come to church that say, what can I do for this church? How can I edify this place? What can I offer to build the church, to build the body of Christ? I mean, I just don't meet people like that. I would like to, but there's not very many of them around because of this consumer mentality that they have. And it's all because we're not thinking correctly. And Paul is saying right here, listen, your mindset ought to be not what can you do to please me, but what can I do to please you? How can I live for you? And in Philippians chapter 2, Paul says this, I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy shortly to you, for I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. Listen to this, for all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. So evidently, this isn't a problem just in our day, right? Paul had the same problem back in his day. Paul said, I'm going to send Timothy Timothy will worry over you. Actually, the Greek word there is worry. There's a sanctified worry. When you worry over God's people, when you worry over the things of God, that's kind of a sanctified worry. And Paul says, I have no one like Timothy who will worry over you, because everyone else is seeking their own thing. They're not seeking the things of Christ. Timothy's different. How sad it is that this is a reality. And so Paul says, you just remember this exhortation that we are to live to please others, not ourselves. And so that's number one. But here's number two. Not only do we remember the exhortation to live for others, but here's the second point that Paul gives us here. Remember the example of living for others. And Paul points to the ultimate example of this principle. Notice verse number three. For even Christ pleased not himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. And so here Paul, again, is pointing to an example of someone who never lived their life to please themselves, but all their life lived to please others. And who personifies that any more than the Lord Jesus Christ? No one. He was the ultimate example of supreme selflessness. He lived his whole life in a total selfless way. In fact, that's the subpoint here. Christ lived a total selfless life. You see, Christ was confronted with the same problem. He was faced with a choice of whether he should please himself or whether he should please others. And Christ always chose to please others. He always set the example by pleasing others. Look at a verse of scripture. Hold your place here in Romans. Go to John chapter 6. And I want you to look at verse number 38. Notice what Jesus says. Look at his own words. John 6, verse 38. For I came down from heaven, John 6, 38, not to do my own will, but what? But the will of him that sent me. I didn't come here to do what I want. I didn't come here to please myself. I came here to do the Father's will. I came to please the Lord. Go back to John chapter 4 and look at verse number 34. Just look at a few verses here with me pertaining to our Lord Jesus. In John 4, 34, Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Jesus again says, I'm not here for myself. I didn't come here to please myself. I came here to please the Father. I came here to do what he wants. Look in John chapter 5. Look in verse number 30. Look in John 5, verse number 30. Again, here's the words of our Lord. He says, I can of my own self do nothing as I hear. I judge. And my judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. And this is just a few verses. I've got a string of them here that I'm not have time to go through every one of them. But if you study it yourself, if you look at the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was constantly living his life to please the Father and living for others. That was his whole life. And by the way, beloved, if you want to talk about the true spirit of Christmas, that's it right there. That's it. He just lived a totally selfless life to please others. And he wanted to please God in spite of the reproach that it would bring upon him. And go back to Romans chapter 15, and look at, again, verse number 3, because Paul is quoting from an Old Testament psalm. Look at verse 3 again. For even as Christ pleased not himself, but as it is written, and he's quoting now from Psalm 69, verse number 9, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. And this Psalm 69 that he's quoting from is a messianic psalm, and it talks about the agony that the Messiah would suffer, the reproaches of those that would reproach God the Father would fall upon Christ. In pleasing the Father, Christ received reproach. He received slander. He received false accusation. He received insults. And he received all of that because he represented God the Father. But he was okay with all of that. He wanted to bear that. He was so anxious in living for what his Father wanted him to do that he said, whatever reproaches fall on you, they fall on me. He was so zealous, so passionate about doing the Father's will that he was willing to bear the insults. He was willing to bear the reproach. He was willing to bear the hatred they had for the holiness of God. is the same hatred they had for the holiness of Christ. Christ was willing to endure everything and anything in order for him to do the Father's will. And so he lived a completely, totally selfless life. But here's the next thing. He lived according to the scripture. Look at verse 4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scripture might have what? Hope. Now, some feel that this verse is somewhat parenthetical. Perhaps it is. But I also think that it's implied here. What's implied here is that the believer take upon himself the total mindset of Christ, and Christ fulfilled the word of God. He completely submitted to all of the written word of God. Even so, we are to study God's word. We are to learn God's word, and we are to submit ourselves to God's word as well. That's really what he's saying here. Scripture is our source of hope. Christ fulfilled the Old Testament scripture of Psalm 69:9, and even so, we as followers of Christ should live according to the scripture. And as we study scripture, it gives us patience, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. It gives us encouragement. It gives us comfort. It gives us endurance. That's why we need to study God's word. Someone says, why do you always study in the scripture down there at that church? Because, friend, this is how we live. We live by God's word. God's word encourages us. God's word gives us hope. We were talking about hope this morning. And this is what God's word does for us. It gives us hope. But also, Christ lived for the glory of God. Look at verse number 5. Now, the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded, one toward another, according to Christ Jesus. And Paul prays that they would have the same mind one to another, that they would have the mind of Christ. That's his prayer. By the way, does this sound familiar? You ever read Philippians where Paul said, you know, be like-minded, having the same love one of another, or have the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you that was also what? In Christ Jesus. Paul's saying the same thing here to the Romans. What you need is you need to have the mind of Christ. If you have a problem getting together and receiving one another, if you have a problem with unity, then what you need to have is you need to have the mind of Christ. Because if you're constantly living for others, you're not going to be offended at other people. If I'm constantly trying to please others and live for others, then friend, I'm not going to have time to be offended. I'm just going to be living for others completely. And I need to have that selfless mind where I'm not thinking or dwelling on my feelings or my rights or my privileges. I'm constantly thinking about others. That's the mind of Christ. And Christ lived this way for the glory of God. And Paul's saying we ought to do the same thing. And so look at how it culminates again in verse number 7. Wherefore, receive ye one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. We do it because we want to glorify God. And let me give you the last point here under the second major point, that we remember the exhortation to live for others. And we remember the example to live for others. That's Christ. And he lived a totally selfless life. We saw that. And he also lived according to the scriptures. He lived for the glory of God. We saw that in verses 5 and 6. Let me give you the last subpoint. Christ lived, we could say Christ received both Jews and Gentiles. Look at verse number 8. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. Now, why does Paul make a big deal out of Jesus received the Jews and Jesus received the Gentiles? Because remember, what's the church at Rome made up of? Jews and Gentiles that were having trouble receiving each other. Maybe it was the Jews that would not eat the meat sacrificed to idols. Maybe it was the Gentiles that were kind of looking down on the Jews because they were still following some of those Mosaic prescriptions about things to do and they couldn't do. They were concerned about diet and days, holy days, Sabbaths, and so on. And again, you have this division brewing between these two groups, the weaker and the stronger, or maybe the Jews and the Gentiles. And what Paul wants to illustrate here now is that our Lord Jesus Christ, guess what? He received the Jews. He ministered to the Jews, but he also received the Gentiles and he ministered to them. He received both groups completely. And he says this in verse number 8, that he was a minister of the circumcision for truth to confirm the promises made unto their fathers. That is, Jesus was a servant of the Jews, meaning he came as a Jew to Jewish people. He came to verify the promises that God made regarding his people. When he says in verse 8, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. And remember, we said this morning, that when Jesus Christ came into this world, it was the fulfillment of all the promises that God had given the Jews and in the Old Testament, so many promises of the coming Messiah. And when Jesus finally came, all of those promises were fulfilled. And Paul says that's why he came, to fulfill all those promises, to minister to the Jewish people. And then he, in verse number 9, it says this, and that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. Not only does he receive the Jews, but Christ receives the Gentiles. And here again, Paul refers to an Old Testament passage that talks about that one of God's plans from the very beginning, when he offered, would be to offer salvation, not just to one specific group of people, Jews, but to everyone in all the world, Jews and Gentiles. And he quotes from, you can write down Psalm 18, verse 49, as is written, for this cause I will confess thee among the nations and sing unto thy name. The word confess means to acknowledge God. And in this verse, the psalmist will acknowledge God in the middle of all the nations. And again, this alludes to Gentile salvation. And look down at verse number 10. And again, he saith, rejoice, ye Gentiles, with his people. And here he quotes from Deuteronomy 32, 43 in verse number 10. And here again, the Gentiles are rejoicing along with the Jews. Look at verse 11. And again, praise the Lord, all ye Gentiles, and laud him, all ye people. And again, he's quoting here from Psalm 117, verse 1. Again, when it's talking about giving praise to God, we see all nations and all people praising God because it was God's plan from the very beginning that salvation would be offered to all people, everyone, Jew and Gentile, everyone. And then finally, look in verse 12. And again, Isaiah saith, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles trust. And again, here he's quoting from Isaiah 11, where in verse 1, where it talks about Jesus being that root of Jesse, and that in him shall the nations, all the nations trust. Now, by the way, this is a perfect passage for Christmas. All of this is talking about what's going to happen when Christ comes, that he's offering salvation to everyone, people all over. And in him shall the Gentiles trust. And finally, look in verse 13. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. And this, again, not that I arranged it because I'm not very smart, but this matches perfectly with the sermon I preached this morning if you were here. And if you weren't here, go ahead and buy the CD. But it's all about hope, the hope that Christ brings at Christmas. And this is what he's talking about here, that the God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, that you might abound in hope. What is the hope? The hope is our salvation, that the message of Christ it will bring joy and peace to the world because we will be reconciled to God because of Jesus coming and bearing the sin of mankind. And it's not just for one specific group. It's for Jews and Gentiles alike. And so Paul's overall point here is, listen, when our Lord Jesus came to minister, he came to minister for everyone. He came to minister to Jews and Gentiles. And the salvation is available to all. And that should be our mindset as well, that we should be willing and desirous to extend the love of God to everyone. It doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, that you are and can be a recipient of this wonderful message of hope that God has given us. And so Paul points to Christ as the example. Paul says, look, if you want to know how to live for others, just look at Jesus. Remember him. Remember how he lived his life. He received everyone. Who did he turn away? He received everyone, no matter where you were from, or who you were. He was our example in how to live according to the scriptures. And he made that very clear. He lived a totally selfless life. He lived to please others. And so this should be the way we want to live. He should be our example. And if you have this mind of Christ, guess what? You're not going to have problems with division in the church. You won't have any problem if you have this mindset. And may God help us to learn from this and have that exact mindset. Let's bow for prayer tonight. Let's bow for prayer tonight. Great passage of scripture from Paul to us. And I want you, with your heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to examine your own heart in light of what you just heard from the scripture. And can you honestly say, I have the mind of Christ. I'm living a selfless life. My desire is not to live for myself or not to please myself. My desire is to live and please others. Friend, if you can say that with absolutely no reservation, then God bless you. But if you're like perhaps most of us, maybe you struggle a little bit in this area of living a selfless life, of having the mind of Christ. Would you take a moment there where you are, and would you just pray and ask God to give you the mind of Christ, especially this time of year when we celebrate the coming of Christ and we talk about the spirit of Christmas. Again, beloved, this is the spirit of Christmas. This is it right here, to live for others, to bear the infirmities of others, to seek to please others. Father, help us. This is a very formidable challenge, because in our hearts, in our life, this is not natural for us to think this way because of this sin nature, Lord, that we all deal with. And so, Lord, I pray that you'll help us to apply what we have heard tonight. Speak to hearts. And how many with heads bowed and eyes closed will say, yeah, that's my prayer tonight. I want to have the mind of Christ. Would you pray for me, preacher, that I would have that mind of Christ by God's grace, that I'll live that way? Father, again, you see the hands and the hearts of these who love you. Lord, help us in this area. Give us the grace to follow in the footsteps and the pattern of our Savior Jesus Christ that Paul points out to us here. May we have the mind of Christ, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.